and acknowledging that we're on Treaty 1 land, the traditional homeland of Métis. I want to welcome everybody that's here in person and those that are watching online, and ask for adoption of the minutes of the previous meeting.
So moved, Mr. Mayor.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Carried. Thank you.
I'd like to move a leave of absence motion for Councillor Mace.
Thank you. Need your vote. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Carried. Thanks. Okay. Delegations. We have Councillor Schreier. Welcome.
Morning. Councillor Schreier is here to be heard with respect to the water and sewer rate increase for 2017-18 public hearings.
Good morning, Your Worship.
Good morning.
Members of the Executive Policy Committee, members of the administration. Just have a few words to say on this. The last meeting of council, my motion was brought forward to hold, for the city in this case, to hold public hearings on the use of water rates.
Okay.
Thank you, Clerk Camero. As I was saying, I'm speaking to this motion which I brought to council, which is in this case to have the city administration run public hearings on the use of water rates. A year ago, I had brought to council a motion for the Public Utilities Board to run public hearings on the issue of the use of water rates for the city of Winnipeg, and the reason for that was simply because they do it for all other municipalities in the province, as well as the province, provincial utilities, including Manitoba Hydro. So I felt it was just logical. They were good at what they did. That was their job, specifically. And that that Winnipeg had an exemption from the Public Utilities Board in terms of the city's utilities being under their jurisdiction was not the point. It was just a singular opportunity for the Public Utilities Board to do what they specialize in. However, I did hear that from council members that they felt uncomfortable about a provincial body having that power over the city, even if it would be just in this singular event of a series of public hearings, presumably. On that basis, in the spirit of this, in the spirit of just listening to council, listening to people's concerns, but nonetheless still listening to people's concerns and knowing that the issue of the use of water rates is an issue to people for various reasons, that I brought forth a motion this time so that the city of Winnipeg runs its own hearings on the use of water rates. Again, I continue to listen to council and to the citizens of Winnipeg on this and others, not just Winnipeggers, but to the extent that people and municipalities north of the city may have concerns in terms of the ramifications of the use of our water rates, if they're not, it's the concerns over the investment into our own water and sewer infrastructure and looking long term into what our obligations are for maintaining our water and sewer infrastructure and what that means for the future of the Red River, for Lake Winnipeg, for municipalities north of us. This is a big issue. There's work to do independent of the decision on this. This is a big issue for the city, and I know we take it responsibly, but to do so, I think, in this very important issue could include, and we'd make a better decision by public consultation on this issue, and I believe I would learn from it as well. There's a number of reasons, and we've spoken about this before, we will again, because this is going to be hitting council, I guess, in 2 weeks. But for me, Councillor Mays did make the point, and I admit in the last council meeting I made a mistake when I brought forth this motion before it was moved to standing committee and EPC to be brought back to council. It's my understanding. I called it a flat tax, and that's a flat, and it's not, of course. It's a form of consumption tax. The reason I said that, and I didn't mean to, and Councillor Mays corrected me, and he was correct in that case, is because it's a different form of consumption tax than most other consumption. We're talking about water. It's a different form of commodity. And in fact, so much so that it's run by a utility. That gives us a great indication of how different water is from most other commodities in our life. It's run by a public utility. Very different. I believe, for the most part, people consume water out of need. We might be spoiled in this country compared to other countries in terms of how we consume water. But that's the basic premise of water. In fact, that's the reason for why I believe it is run as a public utility. And I believe one of the virtues of this country is our fortunate use of water and how we run our water systems so that we maintain a certain level of public cleanliness and hygiene, including through the entire macro sewer systems of our country, which is great for the general health of our country. And therefore, our use of water is beneficial. Of course, it's the most... besides breathing, water is the most important intake into our bodies, or as important as breathing. And on that basis, to look at in terms of taxation, in terms of other commodities, concerns me and others. And that's why I would like to have public hearings on this issue. The reason is we have to consider the fact that Winnipeggers have reduced their water consumption in recent years. I believe Winnipeggers have reduced their water consumption partly out of being the right thing to do and paying attention to these campaigns of reducing water use. But I also believe, there's no doubt in my mind, given how inflation of life, inflation, regular inflation of costs going beyond over years and years, in fact, perhaps decades, going beyond their increase in their wages and salaries, when their property taxes in the poorest neighborhoods of the city have had the highest percentage interest increases in property taxes in the city in the last 12 years. When you look at Elmwood as an example of 40% property tax increases, yes, by virtue of the increase in property values, but because people can afford less and less, and they're competing more and more people are competing in the house market, and as in the consumer house market, in the poorer neighborhoods, and thus the property values go up by virtue of market influences. But nonetheless, we do end up thus with higher mortgages. 40% increases in mortgages in communities like Elmwood. That's a statistical fact which I welcome everyone to check for themselves. And 40% increases in property taxes. Food prices are going up according to information that I've received in these committee rooms while on appeals committees and things like this. Why restaurants say they need to expand is because the cost of food is such, in order for them to maintain their level of financial success. They need to expand because of cost of food. Well, that's one thing for restaurants to say that. What does that mean for citizens of Winnipeg? Who might not be going to a restaurant, they're just trying to make meals for their kids, but the cost of food is going up at such rates. Now, this is the society we live in. This is the point we live in our society, in many neighborhoods, not just in Winnipeg, but throughout the country, but Winnipeg as well. We have a lower cost of living, we have a lower average income, and yet there's certain things that are beyond our control in terms of costs by virtue of international prices, including food. But one thing we can do is we have control over the cost of water. And I do believe that many people, it's not just that they haven't all reduced their water consumption out of merely doing the right thing. They've reduced their water consumption because they had to, because they can't afford it. And then, before this term, water rates were increased. I'm not sure where I am here.
Are you close to wrapping up?
Yes, I am.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. The percentage dividend taken out from water rates to put into general coffers has been increasing. And while Winnipeg has been reducing their water consumption because of this in order to maintain income, we've actually increased the water rates because of reduced water consumption. Well, that I can kind of understand. It's sort of unfortunate. People reduce their water consumption to save money, so water rates go up. But then they go up again, and we increase our percentage dividend to take out of water rates what could be going into investment in water and sewer systems, going into general coffers. And I think this is an issue that needs to be further investigated, and with greater public consultation on that basis, I do believe that we would be well served by having public hearings on the use of water rates in the short term and in terms of a long-term strategy from which we'd all benefit. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor. Questions, comments?
I'll just do a comment. Yeah, thank you, Councillor Schreier. I definitely understand the concern that you're coming from regarding the ability for people to pay. I'm not sure how, paying for water or paying for property taxes or paying for permit fees or paying for traffic tickets, they all have an impact on the individuals, and we have to maintain our, and with Councillor Gillingham and prior work of Councillor Morantz in this council, we have to look at the basket of costs that we're adding to people. So I guess my question would be to you, since they're all intertwined, why would we separate out the water one? Should we have a discussion in general about, okay, so you want to take out the dividend, okay, so that's going to leave a hole. So are you prepared to increase property taxes or cut services? I personally think having that conversation in totality is good rather than trying to isolate things off. Can you respond to that?
Sure. I think discussing these things in totality is inevitable, and I think it's necessary. But you're asking me something, and I don't mind answering the question, but bear in mind in context of the fact that, as I mentioned at the beginning, we have this thing in this province called the Public Utilities Board. So you're asking, why would there be such a mechanism, is basically what I'm hearing. Why is there a Public Utilities Board in the province of Manitoba? Why is every municipality subject to the Public Utilities Board? Why is the province of Manitoba subject to
Again,
the Public
I,
Utilities
I don't really
Board?
Care why there's a pub. I'm asking you why you think we should have a separate hearing separated out from the other. I'm not interested in releasing our control over our budgeting to a third party. I think we are accountable, we're responsible, we should do that.
Yeah.
So again, that's why the pub idea knows so good. So my question is, why should we say, okay, let's take out a transit, and we'll have our own conversation about transit isolated from everything else. Or we'll take it from any other number of things. Shouldn't we discuss them all together and how they're all interlinked?
Yes, I think we should. And I think every municipality should do that when they make their decisions. And I think the provincial government has to do that as well, and I think they do. But all these places, and I guess I'll use the word convention and the logic that I see in terms of answering the question, because I didn't mention the PUB, and you said you didn't want to hear about that. But I have to mention it, because what I'm saying is, if we look at conventions or processes that every other place in this province use, including the province, that makes sense to me. So I'm looking for best practices, just as Marty Morantz's motion did, in terms of looking for ways of safety for drivers and for the public on public transit. Well, you look for best practices. I'm looking for best practices. In this case, it's extremely simple. Winnipeg just simply has an exemption from the Public Utilities Board. But I don't know that we should have an exemption of indefinitely and absolutely in terms of why every other municipality, including the province of Manitoba, including Manitoba Hydro, is subject to public hearings. Yes, we should be looking at this in totality. Bear in mind, Councillor Orlico, that when it comes to water rates, and part of the problem that we had last year is that water rates are set separately from the budget. Of course, it's interlinked and we're warned, well, if you do this, if you don't pass the water rates, we've got a problem with our budget. I understand that. We all understand the connectivity of these things, the interrelationship. But the fact that water rates are set separately is part of the answer to this. It's a separate utility. The rates are set separately. We vote on them separately. Well, that's how separate they are, as the city sees them. That's all right with me. Of course, we have to look at it as in its interconnection, no doubt. But in listening to council saying that we didn't want a provincial body looking over our hearings on this, fine, that's fine with me. I just thought we'd do it, and that was the best way to do it. But if the city wants to run their own based on those concerns I've heard before, that's fine with me. I hope that answers your question. In Manitoba, we held public hearings on water rates and other utilities. And
I hear your comment. Like the other municipalities have to go through this process, so and they have the right to use a pub. So we should be therefore equal to them.
Well, the province does too. I'm not sure if we're equal to the province of Manitoba. We're one of the municipalities within. We're a charter of the province. And I'm not saying that we should be listening to council. I offered Public Utilities Board because I thought it was just the best way to do it. I heard from council, enough council members, that no, we don't want to give the power away to a provincial board, utilities board for hearings. So based on that, Councillor Orlico, I've thus changed the motion so that the city runs it.
I got that. But again, the logic is okay. I don't agree with your logic, but I understand.
Okay. And Councillor Orlico, I guess to answer further, I have to admit, my motivation here isn't, but I've already said this in my presentation. My motivation here isn't merely to hear what people have to say. It's because I've heard enough from what people have to say on this that I believe we're not dealing with our water rates in a way that's representative. That's my opinion, based on, well, what I would call evidence. That's my opinion, and therefore I would like to get that out with an official process of the city. And I think we'd learn more from it than I know. I think that's why other municipalities do this. I think that's why the province of Manitoba does this. And I think that's why the city of Winnipeg would benefit from this, just as we hold budget hearings. But on this one, it's a separate utility and consistent with the rest of the province on whatever level. I think we benefit.
It's unfortunate Councillor Mays isn't here, as I'm sure he would likely have pointed out. There is an opportunity for the public to weigh in on decisions that council makes, not just at the committee level, but executive policy committee, and then also on the floor of council, which is unique to other levels of government where the public has that opportunity for input. I was pleased to hear your thoughts on property taxes and the overall ask of our citizens financially. I hope that means you are supportive of holding the line on property taxes and the overall ask of our citizens. And I do appreciate your comments and the intent of your efforts and comments today. And Councillor Dillingham, did you have?
I appreciate that too.
Your Worship, may I respond to your statement?
Of course, yeah.
Thank you very much. So you did mention that you hope I appreciate on holding the line on property taxes. Well, if I could explain where I'm coming from on this, consistent with things I've said on council floor, you know, for the last couple of years. I've stated this when I've made my little publications in the local Canstar Herald for Northeast Winnipeg and things like this. I believe that property taxes have gone up at a notable rate, a most unfortunate rate of increase in neighborhoods such as Elmwood, as an example. 40% increases in property taxes in 10 years. That's not the case throughout the city. And I got this information initially from Councillor Ross Eady, who did the research. And sure enough, it's true. And so we did, Councillor Eady especially did make council and the public aware of sort of the percentage increases, the differentials throughout the city. And it happens to be that basically the poor neighborhoods have had the largest percentage increase. And they can say, yes, but what does that mean in absolute dollars? Well, first of all, in proportion to income, it's still 40%, basically. People have less disposable income in poorer neighborhoods, especially now than ever before. I don't like property, to cut to the chase, Your Worship, I don't like property taxes. It happens to be the best form of taxation that I believe we have at the disposal of municipal government. I would prefer income tax in the spirit of Canadian income taxation. Consumption tax is good. I think it's fair, except when it comes to something for which we have public utilities that run it, such as water. That's different. It is an absolute need and as important to us as something like, in a Canadian perspective, as Medicare, even more so. So although I don't like property taxes, it's not my favorite form of taxation, it's better than water rates. And also where people are coming from in terms of their expectation of what their water utility, their city water utility, is doing with their funds is a concern to people as well and to me. And I'd like to have a longer term understanding of what our expectation is in terms of how we use our water rates. But Your Worship, in terms of answering your specific question, holding the line on property taxes, Your Worship, going into the first budget, I never said at any point that if we do not keep property taxes below 2%, that I would think something's wrong. It would depend in context of what we're doing with taxation. I have to admit that frontage levies in lieu of property taxes, I think, is worse, because it is a form of flat tax, which if you look at the design of Old Winnipeg, North End to River Heights, many streets in the North End compared to River Heights are virtually identical design, and they're using very similar frontages. Therefore, a house in the North End pays the same frontage levy as a house in River Heights. And I think that goes against the spirit of taxation in this country, in my perspective. And on that basis, Your Worship, to answer your question, I would rather raise property taxes than have frontage levies.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Have a great day. Okay. Let's get into our reports. First report is report one, which is rezoning 489 491 Cordon Avenue.
So move, Mr. Mayor.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Carried. Report two, subdivision rezoning 376 Marion Street.
So move, Mr. Mayor.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Carried. Report three, subdivision rezoning 9 Barrington Avenue.
Again, it's the priority rezoning process. Again, means no opposition, which I love. So moved.
All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Report four is single source award contract supply of software update license and support agreements for the city's PeopleSoft system.
So moved.
Councilor Gillingham.
Thank you. Just want to make a quick comment, Mr. Mayor. Just to reiterate again as we go to the financial impact statement that these funds, just over $1 million, are available through the 2017 Corporate Support Services approved operating budget. And so this is not net new. This is not a net new ask. Just want to, you know, it's $1 million, a big number. Just want to assure people that it was already a part of the 2017 adopted budget.
Thank you.
Thanks.
All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Report five is a request to establish a housing roundtable.
I'd like to move that.
Sure.
I know it's a big discussion on the Housing Steering Committee, and the province had a nice roundtable that included many community groups, and we're hoping that we can get that reestablished again. So,
thank you, Councillor.
I just want to give thank you, public thank you to MLA Scott Fielding. We've been at many events together in the recent couple of months. He's actually quite engaged and very open to working with the city on housing matters. He's been nothing but an open door for me to give calls to and ask, you know, what direction they're going, working with the federal government program. So I agree with this motion. I think there's a great opportunity. There's a very good willingness by Mr. Fielding to work together, and this will help formalize that.
Thanks. Okay, call the question. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Report six is Winnipeg Housing Steering Committee 2017 first quarter report.
So moved.
All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Report seven, business improvement zones, image routes, and neighborhood main streets funding grants agreements.
Mr. Mayor, I will move this report.
All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Report eight is Take Pride Winnipeg Snow Angels pilot program.
I'm happy to move this. I believe the staff is asking for a 60-day extension. So I'll move a 60-day extension.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Thank you. And we'll move to audit committee. First is the annual consolidated financial statements for the City of Winnipeg for the year ended December 31st, 2016.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'd like to just make a couple of comments on this before I make the motion to receive this report. Annually, the city prepares a set of consolidated financial statements, including notes and schedules. They're prepared in accordance with the Canadian Public Sector Accounting Standards recommended by the Public Sector Accounting Board of Chartered Professional Accountants of Canada. And KPMG will be issuing an unqualified audit opinion of the consolidated financial statements as well. The 2016 consolidated financial statements reflect the city's financial position, the result of our operations, including organizations controlled by the city. Council approved investments made in 2016 in capital assets and totaled $476 million, which really reflects the fact that as a city, as a council, we're trying to be very strategic in our investment for a growing city, to accommodate growth, but then also to ensure that we maintain the assets that we do have. While investment in infrastructure continues to be a priority, the city has achieved a disciplined balance for capital spending with increased revenues and responsible long-term borrowing, as affirmed by the city's credit ratings, Standard & Poor's, and as AA and Moody's Investors Services, AA2. I think what's key to note here, Mr. Mayor, and to my colleagues as well, is that these consolidated financial statements demonstrate our commitment to fiscal responsibility, to responsible fiscal planning, again, while investing in the quality of life improvements for the citizens of Winnipeg. And this council approved investments in capital assets, including infrastructure projects, as I said, totaled $476 million in 2016, supported by a disciplined balance for capital spending with increased revenues and responsible long-term borrowing. And I do want to just highlight again that the city's credit ratings affirm solid fiscal performance. Standard & Poor's and Moody's, as I mentioned a moment ago, citing the city's disciplined fiscal planning and strong financial management. And so as we look ahead, a couple of other, I think, things we need to note is that we will continue to make our best efforts, very concerted efforts at controlling our expenses, being very careful with our expenditures, and careful with our costs as well. And and also being very aware of our indebtedness and making prudent decisions when we talk about taking on any more debt, long-term debt for intergenerational projects. Currently, our net total long-term indebtedness is just over $1 billion, and so we're very aware of that. We keep a close eye on that when we're making all decisions. It's a balance between making strategic investments, because we can't just shutter the place, right? You got to make strategic investments, like I said, for a growing city, but also make sure that we are really managing our costs and expenditures. And so that's just some of the highlights. I know that Mr. Ruda, our CFO, is here, Mr. Mayor, and as well as Paul Olson, who authored the report, and their team, if there's any questions about the details of the report. But I'll leave it at that.
I'll just say thank you to you and, of course, our public service, specifically our finance department, the stewardship, and I know your efforts as chair have been very much appreciated, like the previous chair and his efforts in the first 2 years of our term. So I appreciate your comments today and your efforts.
Thank you. I would, if there's nothing further than Mr. Mayor, I'd move the report.
Sure. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. So we'll move to the committee reports. First is the Standing Policy Committee on Water and Waste Riverbank Management and the Environment.
Yes, and Councillor, I'll move this on behalf of Councillor Mays. The May 1st report of items 1 and 2 is consent.
Okay. So just for clarity, first one is disapproving, second is following the recommendation of. Okay, so yeah, we're good. Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Move to Infrastructure Renewal and Public Works Report.
Mr. Mayor, I will move item number, sorry, I can't recall. Can I four? Do these all at the same time?
One,
yeah,
four?
Yeah, you yeah one through four, if you want.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. And last but not least, Finance.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. The report is before us on the insurance settlement for water claim damage, Winnipeg Police Service headquarters. And just to highlight, it was we did talk fairly extensively at our finance committee in regards to the settlement. The settlement recommended reflects a recovery of 92.3% of the adjusted claim. The average recoveries from their for claims of this size, approximately 90 to 95%. So it's certainly within the range, and I would move this report.
Okay. Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Motion to
move consent the agreement.
All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Thanks very much. Have a good day, everyone.